Hello and welcome to the Cassandra Essentials tutorial series. My name is Robin Schumacher and I'm Vice President of Products here at DataStax. In this tutorial, we'll be taking a look at data partitioning and replication in Cassandra. So first I'll give you an overview of partitioning. We'll talk about how to set up data partitioning. Then we'll turn our attention to replication and the various replication strategies that you can deploy in Cassandra. We'll take a look at how replication is actually carried out. And then we'll finish by telling you where you can get Cassandra. So what is data partitioning? Well, Cassandra is a distributed database management system, and this means it takes a single logical database and distributes the actual data amongst one or more physical machines in a database cluster. So when you insert data into Cassandra, it assigns a row, a particular row key, and based on that row key, Cassandra assigns that row to one of the nodes in your cluster that's going to be responsible for managing it. Now, there's a couple different data partitioning strategies that you can use in Cassandra. The first is the random partitioning strategy, and this is the default and recommended strategy. So once again, when you insert data into Cassandra, it's going to use an MD5 hash of the row key. Based on that row key, it's going to assign that row to a node in your cluster that's going to be responsible for it. Now again, this is the recommended strategy because it ensures an even distribution of data throughout all the nodes in your cluster. The second partitioning strategy is the ordered partitioner. And as its name implies, it stores data in sorted order across the nodes in your cluster. However, again, this is really not the recommended strategy because a number of different issues can arise when you use the ordered partitioner, such as having a write hotspot in your cluster, such as nodes having a lot of data, other nodes having very little. So once again, unless you really have to use the ordered partitioner, it's recommended that you use the random partitioning strategy in Cassandra. Well, setting up data partitioning is very, very easy. All you do is assign the partitioner option in the main Cassandra configuration file, the Cassandra YAML file, and Cassandra takes care of everything else for you. There's really nothing else that you have to do. The only thing you do need to keep in mind is if you change the partitioning strategy, you will have to reload all of the data in your cluster. So now let's take a look at replication. So you've got your data distributed amongst all your nodes in Cassandra. That's all well and good. But what if one of the nodes fails? Well, if you want to ensure fault tolerance in your database cluster, you want to enable replication so that you store copies of your rows on one or more nodes in your database cluster. And this is carried out by using what's called the replication factor in Cassandra. So a replication factor of 1 means basically there is no replication that occurs. A replication factor of 2 means it's going to store the original row on one node and a copy of that row on one of the other nodes in your cluster. And this replication factor is controlled at the key space level when you create a key space in Cassandra. Now there's a couple different replication strategies you can use. The simple strategy simply places the original row based on its partitioner, and then a copy of that row is going to be put on the next node walking clockwise throughout your cluster. That's the simple strategy. The network topology strategy is a little bit more sophisticated. It gives you a little bit more control over where your rows are placed in your database cluster. This is what allows you to place different rows on certain racks in your data centers or to carry out geographical replication between one or more data centers. So what happens here is when you insert data into Cassandra, it's going to again assign the original row to a node based on the partitioner that you use. Then it's going to try to find a node on a different rack. And if it finds one, it's going to insert a copy of that data there. If it can't find one, it's just going to insert a copy of that row on any node that it finds, walking again clockwise through your cluster. If you want to replicate data between different data centers, you use what's called a replica group in Cassandra. And this is what maps your rows to one or more, again, physical data centers. And again, this is handled when you create a key space in Cassandra. So what you're looking at now is a CQL, a Cassandra query language example, of creating a key space in Cassandra that uses the network topology strategy, assigns a replica group, in this case DC1, and the number of replicas, 3. So you're going to have the original row stored in your database cluster and 2 copies of that data stored on other nodes in your database cluster. So you might wonder, how does replication actually work? How does Cassandra actually replicate the data between different racks and different data centers and things like that? Well, Cassandra uses what's called a snitch to determine where to place the data in your database cluster. And again, this snitch is defined in the Cassandra YAML file. And there's 4 basic snitches that you can define. The simple snitch uses the simple strategy, again, places a copy of the row on the next available node walking clockwise through your ring. The rack inferring snitch automatically tries to place copies of rows on different racks in your data centers. And it assumes, given an IP address, that the second part of that IP address identifies a data center, third part identifies the actual rack. Well, you might say, well, that's not how my data centers are laid out, and that's fine. You can then use the property file snitch, where you use a file and define how your data centers are laid out, assign that to Cassandra, and that's what it'll use to actually replicate the data across your database cluster. If you want to use Cassandra in the cloud, then you can use the EC2 snitch. Instead of IP addresses, what it's going to use is an AWS API to figure out regions, availability zones, and things like that. Now, the other thing that you need to keep in mind is, even though data is replicated across all the nodes in your cluster, you really don't have to worry about where you read or write. Cassandra is a read-write-anywhere architecture, so you can connect to any node in any one of your data centers, read and write data from that, and Cassandra is going to take care of automatically partitioning that data, replicating that data throughout all the nodes in your cluster. There's nothing special that you have to do. So you might wonder, well, I'd like to try this out. Where can I get Cassandra? If you go to datastax.com, you will find our downloads page where we make available free Smart Start installers that include the most up-to-date version of Cassandra, a version of DataStax OpsCenter, which is a browser-based visual management tool for managing and monitoring Cassandra, drivers and connectors, a sample database and application. Installers include a configuration assistance for ensuring that you get the best out-of-the-box performance from Cassandra, and a getting started guide. You'll also find other materials at datastax.com. We have free online documentation, technical white papers, articles, tutorials, and a whole lot more. So that concludes this tutorial. For everyone here at DataStax, I'd like to thank you for your time and wish you a great day.